Royalty. Royalty. Powers of the chosen people.
Okay, so we're going to actually work our way through each of these Hebrew words. So today, you guys are going to get a little thrill because we're going to talk about the birds and the bees. And for a very important reason. One, because nobody talks about it anymore. And two, I don't think anybody knows what they're supposed to be doing. And I'm not just talking about necessarily the physical act, but everything that is encompassed in it. And because you don't see things Hebraically, you only see what somebody explains to you. Where in areas like this, Yah is very, 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 he's very open about it. And we don't see it because we live in a culture that suppresses anything that seems sexual or it's abused. And so whenever it's talked about, it's always in a negative. And then it's always for somebody and it's not mutual or balanced. Mm-hmm. And so what we're going to cover today is what Scripture says, and then I'm going to blow 1 Peter 3:7 out of the water with what it actually says from a Hebraic standpoint, because when you look at things through a Greek lens, what you get is a perversion sometimes, or you lose the whole meaning. And this is one of those passages that has caused a lot of confusion. Because you can't see the meaning in English. You'll never see the meaning in English. So I'm going to talk about 1 Peter 3:7 and Genesis 4. And so our launching pad will be, what does it mean when it says, and Adam knew Eve? Mm-hmm. Right? And so in the Bible, you'll see those words. And we'll work our way through these words. And what you're going to experience, and I hope it's something very similar to what I experienced, is that the Most High, like we've been seeing, has a pattern and a structure for the family, that if you can't see it, then you can't duplicate it, and then you live making your own rules and defining your own things, and then you put unnecessary burdens on people. That was one of the things that was a big issue for the Hamasiyah. It was like, you keep adding these burdens to people that you can't even keep. Well, in relationships, burdens have been added to women by men, and then it's not reciprocated because it's really something that one is not based in Scripture, or it's based in your interpretation of Scripture, and two, it's not something that is actually real. It's based upon a Greco-Roman perversion. And I did another video on, what was the video that I just did recently? And I was talking about how there's like a perversion and the Greeks looked at this. Oh, submission. And so that would probably be a good place to start if you haven't seen that video, because I know that's a question a lot of people have. But we'll start here. So I'm not skipping over that verse. It's just already been done. So if you guys want to turn to 1 Peter 3:7. And you have it.
Mm-hmm.
You want to read it?
Yep. Husbands, likewise. Dwell with them with understanding. Give honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered.
Okay, so immediately the thing that every person pulls out of that verse is the weaker vessel. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's right. Not consistent with the rest of Scripture. Mm-hmm. So in 1 Peter 3:7, it says, dwell with her as the weaker vessel. So we have a lot of examples from Genesis all the way through, and obviously in our other lessons, where we talk about what the actual woman's role is and what her actual function is. So we get to this verse and it says that she's weak. So I looked it up in the Greek. I'm like, well, maybe it just says that and it's a bad English translation. Well, in the Greek, it literally says that she's sick, she's feeble, she's like frail, like unstable. And I'm like, wow, how is it, right? How is she a virtuous woman, which means a strong woman, if when you see her in the New Testament, she takes on a different form? So not only does the Hamasiyah take on a different form, but even the woman takes on a different form. And the only thing that you have is this dominant male picture, And then every man leeches to that and says, now submit and do everything I say because you're weak and you don't know how to do nothing and you just falling all apart anyways. And you're like, you know what? Maybe that's right. Maybe I should. It's like, that's not what it means. So I'm going to read you. Very, very rarely do I use this translation. I don't recommend it as a actual Bible. But sometimes when stuff is mistranslated or is where it loses its meaning in the Greek, the Orthodox Jewish Bible, which is a Bible written by Caucasian Ashkenazi Jewish people, and what it's written for is they're taking the New Testament and they put the cross references for New Testament verses toward the Old Testament, because remember, one thing about Jews is that, one, they don't want to believe anything in the New Testament, and because they believe it contradicts the Old Testament. So what this group of people have done is gone through and then put in the Hebraic understanding behind all the verses. Mm-hmm. So even if it doesn't have a direct translation, then it's going to have the Hebraic understanding behind it. So this verse, 1 Peter 3:7, is the Orthodox Jewish Bible, and I'll tell you all the words, what they mean. So it says, likewise, ba'alim, husbands, dwell with them according to the da'as, knowledge, of the Isha as a keli raka, weaker vessel, showing them kavod, as also being your ashim together of the matan, a gift, of the hen vaheser ha-chaim, so that your tefilos, or your tefilah, will not be hindered. Same exact thing. If you don't know those words, they're right there in your Bible. Read the same way. But the thing that it gave me the definition for was as a weaker vessel. So, grab my little handy board. So, weaker vessel, right? So, in Hebrew is, and I don't know if it's on your page, but I have it on mine. It's weaker is the word raka. So, resh, I'm going to write it down on here. And a vessel is kaf. So, these are your words. I'll fix it on there. I'm just gonna add it into the actual edit. So weaker vessel, right? So rachak cheli, right? And interesting thing about this is Hebrew is concrete, remember? So if something's vulgar, Hebrews don't care if it's vulgar to you. All they care about is that you got the understanding of what they meant. So this is spelled like this.
Keli racha.
All that they care is that you understand the meaning. How you feel about how they explain it doesn't matter, because they don't want you to misunderstand what they say. You know how we say stuff and we're like, I do. Oh, right, like I don't want you to miss this. So repeat it back to me. Mm-hmm. Did you catch that? All right, so offensiveness doesn't matter. So being prudent in their speech, if they're not being vulgar, I'm just trying to get you to get the correct understanding, because if I let you walk away and you don't understand, then we'll be doing what we're doing right now. Women are weak, they need men because they're feeble and they're sickly and they're frail and they can't do anything. It's not what it means. So literally what this means, and you can always fact check me, but I'm gonna give it to you fast so we can move on to the other stuff. It literally means the word racha, means tender, delicate, and soft. Mm. Okay? And the word keli, or heli, is a vessel that holds something. So the word actually means the tender vessel that's soft, that holds something. He literally says, handle the woman like you handle your nuts. It's literally what it says. Because, you know, it's they're tender. I'm swearing you, that's exactly what it says. They're tender and they're soft. It's like, because it literally says balls, but I mean, wow. I thought, it says literally, because that is something that a man can immediately relate to. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, no. You don't want somebody to hit you there.
Plainer than that.
Right. You don't want somebody to hit you there. You don't want them to mishandle them. You want them to handle them with care. Like, so what he's saying is, this is something you can relate to. Handle her like you would handle that. Now, that doesn't make them weak, because they carry strength. They carry the strength of the family in them. But on the outside, you can damage the family if you handle them roughly.
Yes.
So you see how, now when you read that whole thing, now that makes sense. He's like, so don't abuse her. Would you abuse your own self? And so he just gets to the chase. Now, would you like if somebody hit you in your balls? You know, like, you'd be like, no. Okay, Peter, I get it. And because we know the temperament of Peter, we know that's what he said. Peter has never been one to bite his tongue. And so you're getting these saintly people when you translate it into Greek and then English, but these were still the same people with the same personality who were not afraid to say what they were saying.
Wasn't it, even in Torah, it was punishable if you kicked a man in the nose.
If you grab a guy,
grabbed him in his testicles,
in his testicles during a fight with another man, your husband will have to let that other man cut your hand off. Because the men are just fighting, right? But you can damage his progeneration, the rest of his family. So this is very, very serious. That's the same way if you put your hands on a woman, then if you relate it back to Torah, then it is also something that is detestable.
You're damaging your family.
Right? Next it says, likewise. So the thing he says, dwell with them according to knowledge. So we know she's not a weaker vessel. So now let's look at what knowledge is. Okay? So knowledge in the Hebrew, and I mean, I'm always using this ancient Hebrew lexicon because it gives us the pictures. So if you have one of these, it's on page 96. And the idea of knowledge, right? It's dalet ayin. So I'm going to write it on here. So it's a dalet and an ayin. And it's the word da. It's really like da. So it's this. So da. And the word, as you can see, it's a dalet. So it has to do with a door, right? And an ayin. And so this word for knowledge, right, has to do with the idea of an eye, which is obviously to see, and a door. And it means through the eyes, one experiences the world and learns from it. Okay? Combine these pictures mean the door of the eye. The eye is a window into the man's very being. Experience is gained through visual observation. Knowledge is achieved through the experiences that you get through your visual observation. So it says, dwell with them according to knowledge. So it means to watch her, see what she does, and learn her, and then do or follow through on those things. Right? So this will all make sense in a second. So he's supposed to be watching her. Mm-hmm. So it's funny because women naturally do it. When a woman is interested in a man, and you probably remember this all the time, but she's going to watch what he likes, what kind of women he likes, where his eyes go, what he likes to eat, where he frequents. Is he a leg man? Is he a butt man? Is he an eye man? And you're going to enhance those things because you're learning him. You're learning his mannerism. You know what makes him tick. You know what makes him happy. You know what makes him sad. You know everything that he likes, right? And we're doing it, but Yah tells the man, the commandment is actually to the man to do it. When Yah doesn't give a commandment to a certain party, it's not because the thing is not supposed to be reciprocated. He normally gives a commandment to the person who is not going to naturally do it. You need to be told to do it. And then the other person naturally is going to reciprocate. So do you have to tell a woman to know your husband, watch your children, watch your family? Mm-hmm. No, but for a man, men can get caught up in other things and then they don't pay attention. And so they're not paying attention to this or to that in particular. So Yah tells them, dwell with her according to knowledge. Okay? Let's go to the next verse. Genesis 4. And it's verse 1. It says, and Adam knew his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain and said, I have gotten a man. So immediately, we see the idea of knowing then having something to do with sexual relations. right? But it's not just like regular sex. See, there's different words for just regular sex. Adam didn't just lay down with Eve, right? Because there's a word for that. We'll get to that. Adam knew her. So here's another word. It comes from the same root, the two-letter root. So the word is yada. So if you just put... And it's funny because it's...
Da. Mm-hmm.
So you put the ode. So yada. And the word means... Now, we said knowledge is da'a. This one means to know. And this is not just a knowing of, you know, regular sex. You're not just getting to know this person because I know you because I slept with you. Mm-hmm. No. This means to know not just with the body, but with the heart and the mind. Difference, right? Okay, so this one's off of page 99. And this one is actually the actual translation of Dalit. What am I looking at? Yod Dalit. Right, Yod Dalit Ayin. So this one is the idea of to watch. So we have the knowledge, but it also means to perceive, to understand, to acquaint, to consider, right? Because, oh, I don't have to ask my wife nothing. Oh, but if you knew her, then you would consider how she felt. You wouldn't have to ask her anything because you would already know how she would feel about it because you would know her, right? Okay, so the yod in front of this, you know, the yod is arm and hand, work, deed. So it's not just to now see and watch and know, but now it's to do it too. It has action behind it now. Oh, I know my wife, but I'm not going to actually do what I know is conducive for her. Now this says not only did he know her, but he did what was good for her. So then sexually, if a man knows you, then he also does what is good for you. Okay, we'll get a little bit more into that. Okay, and it says, so there's a difference then. There's a word, there's a verse in Numbers 31:17. And we've gone through it in Shabbat school. Remember when they got all the Moabites and the people from and the Midianites after Cozbi and the priest got together and he slew all the people? Mm-hmm. And he says, bring all the people. And he says, now kill every woman that has known a man, mm-hmm. right? So this is not just merely sex. So Yah automatically knows culturally that sex was something in the Hebraic culture that was more than just procreation and getting pleasure mm-hmm. and to get what you want. It was way more than that. So it's higher than it is now. The reason why he says, kill the women who have known a man, uses the word yada, is because this woman not only has known a man, like she's been with him, but a man has known her. So not only is somebody been, she'd been in somebody else's head and bed, but somebody's been in her head. Mm-hmm. Meaning that he doesn't just know her, but every fiber of her being is connected to him. Mm-hmm. This man has known her. She's attached to him. Everything about her reflects something about him and his home and his family and his values. You can't have a woman like that. Mm-hmm. The reason why you can't have a woman like that is because a woman who has had a man who has known her
will always love him,
and she's loyal only to him. It's a natural reciprocation. When a man knows a woman, then she reciprocates only to him. Mm-hmm. That's a woman a man doesn't have to worry about. Mm-hmm. I know her. You know? And men say it about certain women, like, I know her. She wouldn't do that. Right. And you know it because you know what you've put in and the work and the time you've put into that woman. Mm-hmm. So you know her. Okay? So another verse to show you that know has a lot to do with knowing also what's going on is Genesis 31:32. And so, I don't know if you guys remember the story, but Rachel is leaving her father's house. She's leaving Laban's house. And Laban comes out and he's like, you took some of my idols. And Jacob's like, don't I have none of your idols? And he's like, no, it's missing. And he's like, whoever has it, you check. And whoever has an idol, they'll die. They're gonna die. And so, you know, he didn't know what he was saying because he loved Rachel. But she says she was on her period, but she was sitting on the idol. That's why she didn't get up. oh, Father, no, I can't get up because, you know, I'm unclean right now. Mm-hmm. And I'm sitting on the idol. I took an idol from my father's house. So in later on, his words come to be, and she actually ends up dying in childbirth when she has Benjamin. But it says that Yaakov didn't yada that Rachel had the idol. He didn't know, which means that he didn't really know what was going on. Mm-hmm. It's one of the things about having a big family and more than one wife is that sometimes things slip through the cracks and it can be a detriment for your family and for the one that you love. Your attention can be divided, and the idea of knowing is to be watching everything. But he was trying to get out of there because Laban was going to put him there for probably 7 more years of hard rain. Okay, so the next thing is, if you're supposed to know somebody before you sleep with them, meaning I'm not going to just sleep with you before I know you, right? So the word, the next word is shakab. So you don't shakab before you yada, okay? Mm-hmm. So you don't lie down, right, before you know a person. And there's a ramification for that, because the people who lie down before they know somebody encounter a specific type of person, and even Torah talks about that. So Deuteronomy 22 and 28. And this is, Yah's word is something, it's a force to be reckoned with when it begins to open itself up in front of you, because everything just becomes plain and certain things that don't make sense just all make sense. Deuteronomy 22:28. It says, so it's talking about men who take women, okay? He says, but unto the damsel, okay, so start at 25. But if a man find a betrothed damsel in the field, and the man force her and lie with her, then the man only that lay with her shall die. So this is literally rape, okay? So he's supposed to die. God doesn't play about that. But unto the damsel thou shalt do nothing. There, you shouldn't do anything to her. There is in the damsel no sin worthy of death. For as when a man rises against his neighbor and slay him, even so is this matter, right? For he found her in the field, and the betrothed damsel cried, and there was none to save her. Okay, so she was literally raped. So look at this. If a man find a damsel that is a virgin, which is not betrothed, and lay hold of her and lie with her, and they be found, then the man that lay with her shall give unto the damsel's father 50 shekels of silver, and shall be his, and she shall be his wife, because he hath humbled her, and he may not put her away all of his days. So it looks like a man, one man rapes a woman and he dies. But it looks like if this woman doesn't cry out when she's raped, then obviously the other man doesn't die. That's not what Torah says at all. Which is like, it was like, I always was like, so maybe just take a woman and just be with her. Okay, so then the story, do you remember the men of Shechem? Shechem. Remember, and they laid with Dinah. And they said that she was raped, right? Mm-hmm. That's not what happened, because the guy was not a rapist. He didn't, I mean, his attitude was not one of rape. Mm-hmm. He actually really, really liked her, right? So then what happened? We all know. We all say it. We said, Dinah got out there and started looking at those women, and then she got caught up, right? So the word here, when it says, and if he lay hold of her, so this is like crazy, because it doesn't mean anything off the surface. The word literally translates as, it's a tambourine. It's very interesting, right? So the word is, it says if he take hold, the word is tefesh. So it literally means to take, the take hold means tefesh. And it's literally translated tambourine. Okay, so nobody really understands this unless you grow up in a black cultural church, right? What happens when tambourine gets playing?
Dancing and
people get kind of beside themselves, right? And it makes you kind of lose control of what you got going on, and people get quote unquote caught up in the spirit, right?
Yeah.
It's the same thing for a man lay hold. What it literally means is that he spit game and seduced her.
Seduced.
So he was like he seduced her. He had her thinking like, you know, baby,
we gonna do this.
Look, I'm you know, I love you. You fine? Dang. If you just, I'm going to take care of you and such and such and such. And then what does a girl do? I love you. And then she sleeps with them. My grandma would always tell me that. She would go, don't let a boy come up and tell you that you're cute and that he love you, and then you just sleep with him. You know, she was like, because if he loved you, he wouldn't ask you, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. But you take a person who you see this guy, he's attractive, and like all the little Canaanite girls are like, ooh, he's fine. And then he come up to you and be like, hey, well, I've seen you around here. All these girls want me, he want to talk to me. And he starts spitting his game. And then next thing you know, you're sleeping with him, right? So what Torah says is when you seduce her and you get her to lay down with you, now you have to marry her. See, that's another cultural thing. It was a past cultural thing, but if you slept with a guy, especially if you got pregnant back in the day, he had to marry you. No, 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 you took my daughter, now she's yours. She's yours. That was not acceptable back in the day. Why? You spit your game and you thought you were slick. You're not going to be sleeping with her and then she's living in my house and I still got to take care of her and you're just benefiting from the booty. That doesn't work like that. Yah's the same way. And now you can't divorce her. You can't send her back home because you wanted her so bad that you didn't treat her honorably. Now she's yours.
That's why.
And she let you, and so she needs to go with, you too.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. So the word, literally, there's a word there. So the word shakab, for when you lay with the person, it literally means to remove their covering. Mm-hmm. So you uncovered her, right? Uh-huh. And so it's the word kav. So kaf bet. So it's a covering, right? And the word shak, so it's shin kof, means to pacify. So you removed your covering mm-hmm. to pacify. Now this is where Hebrew gets very, very cool. If you put an aleph in front of that idea of pacify, it means testes. So you removed her covering to pacify your loins.
Mm-hmm. Your loins. Mm-hmm.
So now she's yours, right? So you did that. That's so, what you did. Okay. So you're not supposed to seduce to pacify your loins. If you do, that woman is yours.
It's yours.
Okay. So marriage, obviously, can't have any of these components, mm-mm. right? And we'll get into a couple of others. So marriage is supposed to be first companionship. You need to yada before you shakab. Mm-hmm. You need to know the person before you uncover them. So everybody thinks that arranged marriages were like this thing where you never saw this person or your parents just picked him, you had to marry him. Well, in Hebrew culture, and most Eastern culture, but definitely Hebrew culture, if you were betrothed, like your parents chose your mate, and they said, this will be a good fit for you, you had to meet the person first before you married them, right? You had to get to know them. And if you found that this person was not somebody for you, you could say, woman or male, no. Because you don't enter into a covenant, right, with someone without knowing them. So we're going to go to this next word. It's the word da'at. So it's on page, I believe, 99 of this book. Same thing, dalet tet. So a dalet is a door, right? Mm-hmm. I mean a tet. Dalet tav. A dalet is a door, and a tav is a mark, sign, covenant, right? Mm-hmm. So literally, right, you don't enter into a covenant. It literally means law. So it means a picture of a door, meaning an entrance. And the entrance, it means entering with a mark, right? When two parties agree to follow the laws of a covenant, a mark is given as a sign of continued allegiance. So when the man enters into the woman, he leaves a mark. And this becomes now a sign of their covenant. And this is where your allegiance is to. You don't just start entering into a bunch of doors, making a bunch of marks, and then leaving. You don't shakab. You don't lie with a person and make a covenant with a person or enter into a person if you have not yada, if you don't know them. Or you get stuck with the ramification of pacifying your loins. Okay? That's what happens. So, marriage is first companionship. You actually have to like and know the person. You should have invested. You should have watched. You should have intently watched. You should know them. Okay? And then second, it's sexual. So then you can see this. The first part of the covenant is the betrothal, where you get to know the person. You know their family. You get to start researching. If you know you're getting ready to marry somebody, you're like, okay, I want to see what he likes and what he knows. Because part of the idea of a bride and a groom or a betrothal is that it's a knowing period. Your mother starts to teach you. You know yourself. Mm-hmm. You begin learning things. He goes home to his father and begins learning things. We're going to touch on that in a second. And then you guys begin to know one another. There's no sex involved in the betrothal period because sex confuses things.
Yes.
When you're dating, dating is to know, right? To yada, not to shakam, not to lie with. Now, the knowing can turn into the shakam later, but you're not supposed to uncover until you're ready to make a commitment. Okay, so that's for all the young women and a married woman. Okay, so sex is supposed to be satisfied within the confines of marriage, right? So if sex is supposed to be satisfied within the confines of marriage, then this means that now there has been a covenant that's entered into. And there are certain rules, natural rules for this covenant. We can make rules between me and you. There's natural rules for this covenant. Some of the natural rules for this covenant is the marriage bed is not defiled, right? Which means that sexual immorality does not enter the marriage bed, and there are not things that you cannot do within your marriage bed outside of bringing in uncontracted parties. Mm-hmm. You're not a part of this contract. You're not supposed to be in this bed. And a contract is between a man and a woman, mm-hmm. Okay? That's just how scripture lies it out. The positive, negative. Male and female, that kind of thing, okay? And it's supposed to be satisfied within that confine. So, and forgive me, ladies, but a man is not supposed to be satisfying himself outside of the confines of this contract, and likewise the woman. We are to satisfy one another. If we can't satisfy one another, we need to talk about that. Mm-hmm. But you having things, or what the Bible calls immorality, and we'll get to that word, and me having immorality and doing things separate outside of the contract is a breach of contract, mm-hmm. right? That's just like two people in contract into a business to make some money, but then somebody's taking the merchandise and making money on the side, that ain't cool, right? It's the same thing. If we've contracted to please one another and to satisfy one another in all of our desires, then we have to do it with one another, mm-hmm. okay? So the idea of lust, right? Is we think of it as like, oh, when I look at a person, I really, really, really desire them, right? But sexual immorality in the form of lust is more than that. So I was talking to my aunt the other day, and we were discussing how men, even Hebraic men, have a certain standard for a woman. And we've heard in our culture as, I want a lady in the streets and a freak in the sheets, right? It's literally what they say. And this idea, though, is foreign to Torah, because a man, if you wanted that, then you would not have married the woman. You would have married the whore. Mm-hmm. All the whores that you slept with before you got with the woman, mm-hmm. right? But you chose this woman because her qualities were the opposite of what the whore was. You chose her because you had to earn her. You didn't have to earn these women. But now when you get into a relationship with this woman and you think she's supposed to just do whatever no matter how you treat her. But the natural inclination of the woman, of a woman, a real woman, is that if you hurt my feelings, mm-hmm. if you disrespect me, if you're not upholding your end of the bargain, it's not that I'm punishing you by not sleeping with you. It's that I can't do it. The thing that attracted me or drew me to you has now become detestable. And it can go both ways, right? So the idea of a person just being this common whore is foreign to scripture also. So we'll look at Ezekiel. So sexual immorality does not have a place in the marriage. And Ezekiel talks about this, and he's actually dealing with a whore. And he talks about what happens when sexual immorality then becomes a part. So we're going to turn 23 and 7. And he says, thus she committed her whoredoms with them, with all them that were the chosen men of Assyria, and with all on whom she doted. With all their idols she defiled herself, neither left she her whoredoms brought from Egypt, for in her youth they lay with her, and they bruised the breast of her virginity and poured their whoredom upon her. Wherefore I have delivered her into the hand of her lovers, into the hand of the Assyrians upon whom she doted. These discovered her nakedness. They took her sons and her daughters and slew her with the sword, and she became famous among women, for they had executed judgment upon her. If you get a woman that's a whore, and the reason why you don't get one is because she has not had anybody yada her. Mm-hmm. So she's committed to nobody but her own sexual pleasure. The same thing for a man. It goes both ways. If a man has never allowed a woman to know him, then he's only committed to his own sexual pleasures. And it's very hard to enter into a contract or a covenant with a man who's only concerned with his own sexual pleasures and a woman who's only concerned with her own sexual pleasures, because what will happen is when you don't fulfill those, then she'll go get them somewhere else and he'll go get them somewhere else because they're not knowing one another. The Bible, that's what sexual immorality is. It's when you operate outside of the contract. Yah had a contract with Israel. The whore he's talking about is us as a people. And he's saying, you didn't let go of your whoredom when I married your whole self. That's pretty much what he said. Mm-hmm. That's what he said. He said, you kept doing the same whoredom that you were doing in Egypt. Mm-hmm. And I gave you a chance, but you kept your idols. Mm-hmm. And so then when you got around the Assyrians and they had idols and they started looking good too, then you started whoring around with those idols too. You like anything that. So Paul says that the husband's body belongs to him. And the wife's the husband's body belongs to the wife, mm-hmm. and the body of the wife belongs to the husband. Now, he's not making a new commandment. What he's saying is, okay, so because there is this idea of control that can be put into the situation, now we're in this contract, you can't go out, I can't go out, now I'm making you do whatever I want you to do so you can get some. Doesn't work like that. So he's like, no, don't do it. Because now you're abusing a power, and it's not something that's been given to you. But it's something that's been given to both of you for one another. Okay? So the reason why this is said is because in Torah, sex is not the right of the man. It's actually the right of the woman. Right? So that has been flipped. Everybody keeps thinking, I married you and now you're supposed to have sex with me when I want you to. While that is true in a sense, it's not true that the right was first yours. And so that is that verse you had. Exodus 21 and 10. So when Yah, he's dealing with men who are going to be shikabin and trying to yada a bunch of women. And he says, well, wait. I know y'all came out of Egypt and you had some practices, but let me lay down some ground rules for all you who want to take a whole bunch of wives. There's some things you got to do first. There's some natural conjugal duties that are due your first wife first. Okay? And this makes it really difficult. If somebody is able to do this, he is a stallion. So, Exodus 21 and 10 says, if he take him another wife, her food, talking about the first one though, her food, her raiment, and her duty of marriage shall not diminish. So, sex is not just for procreation, because a woman can get older. And men can take a younger wife and say, oh, I got her because she's, you know, more sexually, you know, vital and vibrant and all these things. And Yah's like, But first, you have to make sure that she has her food, her raiment, and she has to have sex. And it doesn't mean just when you feel like it. That's the cool thing about how Yah sets up things. It's whenever she wants it. Okay? So how this goes is like this. The idea of giving her due diligence, and if he doesn't do this and she leaves her, like she said, you have to let her go and you have to pay her. You have to give her restitution. Mm-hmm. And so the reason why this is like this is because the idea of yada is not a one-time thing, but it's a continual thing. You're always supposed to be knowing her. You're supposed to be growing in knowledge with her. As she matures, you mature. As she grows and desires other things and more things, and you should be watching her. So the idea of yada is to watch. So it's not, a woman is actually never supposed to have to ask a man for sex. He's supposed to watch her and sees when she needs it, just like food and raiment. You should be watching her and watching her clothes and saying, you know, my wife needs some new stockings. She got a little run in her stockings. Her shoes look a little rough. I need to go get my wife some more shoes. See, we are so backwards in our culture that women are doing this for men and men are not doing this for women. So if she's hungry, you should be watching and you should be like, you know what, baby, it's about... Now, my husband's good at this because he's a timed eater. He eats it like after. So it's noon. You hungry? You should be watching. You should be checking with her to see if she's hungry. Those are your duties. The same thing with sex. You should be watching her. You should be... Men act like they can't catch subtle hints until it comes to sex. Man, you can twitch and be like, you want that? My neck is hurting. And no, I don't want you to rub it. Like, it's that serious for them. So he's saying you should know when she wants to have sex. And so if you are trying to have 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 wives, then you can't be watching her. You can't be watching all of them. And what happens when you get a house full of sexually frustrated women? It's all bad. It's all bad. Okay? So a woman should be cared for. And guess what happens? Yah does not have to tell a woman then, and his need shall not diminish. Paul says it, but Yah doesn't have to tell the woman. Why? Because if there's a man who's paying that close attention to you and watching you and making sure you're okay and that you're fed and that you're satisfied all the way around, the natural inclination of the woman is to reciprocate that same thing back to him. Mm-hmm. He doesn't have to worry about it, right? So the idea of this reciprocation, right? I mean, this idea of how he's watching her is the word ayin nun. So it's an eye, and we talked about this before. It's an eye watching the seed. Remember I told you that the idea that it has like a person with a growl? Mm-hmm. Is because a person is intently watching for everything. It's like when a mom, when you're looking at your stomach, and you watch for a baby to move, and then your belly does that little thing like this, mm-hmm. you have to keep your eye close and the baby small. Because you're like, only makes a little flicker. You're like, did you see that? Did you see that? That's how the man should be watching his wife. He should know everything about her. He should know when she moves. And most women hate that about a man. But when you think about it, when you have a man like that and he's watching you, then you know. I have a goddad slash cousin uncle who who buys his wife underwear, right? Mm-hmm. But he goes and he's like, I like these on you. I mean, she has thousands of pair of like unworn underwear because he just like, he'll just go buy them. You won't, and he's serious about it. It's not a game. Like, we would go places and it'd be me and my cousin, and he'd be like, you think she liked these? And I'm like, those are cute. You know? And he's like, I'm buying. And she was almost getting tired of it, but you see, she's watching her. Oh, she likes these kind. Okay, if she likes these, I'm going to get a kind with a lace on them, but they're the same. You know what I mean? So then guess what? She's going to wear them for them, right? Mm-hmm. So you're watching me. You're engaging. Men think that, and this is like the most annoying thing for women, sex is not something where it's when you get in the bed and like, ooh, now there's a warm body next to me. This happens all day. So you should be engaged all day on some level. If you know me and you're watching me, you should be checking out, Daddy cares. Oh, that's cute. We were just having that conversation. Like, the most annoying thing when you're young is a guy who cares too much. You're like, ooh, he doing too much. But then when you get older, you're like, oh, I just want a guy that do too much. I want a guy that cares, and I want a guy that says, oh, you know, I just can't wait till you get home. You know what I mean? Like, that thing. Well, the man who's yadaing a woman, he's making sure that she's taken care of. So how impossible is it for a woman to actually engage in sex when she's not yadaed, when a man doesn't know her? So if you're not watching me intently, then you don't see the fact that I cooked, I've cleaned, I've homeschooled your kids, I've washed all the clothes, I've made you dinner, and now you want me to go get dressed, do my hair, stay fit, get sexy, light candles, run a bath, and then woo you? Mm-hmm. It's not that it's impossible, but what if you're watching me and you're seeing all that I'm doing, and then I'm done, and I put the kids to bed, and I close the door, and I lock the room, and now there's candles, and this, I'm like, well, dang, I was tired, but I ain't tired no more. You see how that works? You want me to do everything. And then you don't want you to have to do anything because you have a backwards, lazy eye. I want to call it that. It is. Exactly. You're supposed to be watching me intently, but your eye wanders. You know what I mean? No, but if you're watching, you'd be like, you know what? I'm going to pick up where she left off. She handled all this. I've got this. And vice versa. If you have a man who's doing all these things and he's a better person domestically than you are, then you turn around and you reciprocate. Well, like, dang, I got you. I'm going to put on my A game.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it's supposed to go both ways. So, next thing. All right. Sex is supposed to be satisfied between the husband and wife. We talked about that. Talked about that. You don't
even
know. Okay. Next one. I'm just going through these. Okay. So, that I brought up this. So, the idea of offering sex does not mean just climbing on top of her in the middle of the night. Or placing her hand on your erect lower area, unannounced, only to be upset when she turns it down. There's no engaging. There has to be more than that within this, okay? So, the idea that a woman is supposed to seduce a man is foreign to scripture also. That's also a trait that is a whore trait. So most of the stuff that men learn is from Greek, Greek, right? Because a woman who seduces a man is seducing him to control him. Okay, I'm trying to control your emotions. I'm making sex a lustful, emotional thing. Not saying you're not supposed to desire one another. There's a difference between desiring a person and then having to always play the harlot to turn them on. Mm-hmm. See, those are two different things. Okay, so the idea of this comes from Proverbs 9:3. One of the things that we're going to have to get in check as a nation coming out of captivity and dealing with a lot of sexual immorality is the idea that every sexual act has to be immoral. Like, you can never connect because everything is so profane. You want to always do things that you see and not actually experience sex, right? Everybody's always out for themselves. Okay, so this idea of a woman having to seduce a man, right, comes from this passage. It says, "Wisdom hath builded her house, and she hath hewn out her seven pillars. She hath killed her beast. She hath mingled her wine. She hath furnished her table." Okay? She didn't kill the food. She has cooked the food. She has made her house look nice, right? And she has sent forth her maidens. She has cried upon the highest place of the city. And then she done called out, "Hey, go call him. I'm ready. I done laid everything out," right? "Whoso is simple, let him turn in hither. As for him that wanteth understanding," she saith unto him. Not simple as in stupid. She means who the one who wants the good thing, the one who wants these things that are pleasurable and easy. I'm not making you work for nothing. Mm-hmm. You don't have to work for this. This is my natural reciprocation for somebody who wants this, mm-hmm. right? The word for understanding is binah. It's the same root word as the word for, and Yah formed man and he built woman, right? So this man knows some things about this woman, and she don't have to put all this out there for him to know that she got what she got. Mm-hmm. All I gotta do is cook you a meal and invite you in. You look around and like, "This is somebody. This is nice. Oh, this work," right? And he says, "Come eat of my bread and drink of the wine which I have mingled." So she don't have to be all nasty. Mm-hmm. Come down and eat. Drink a little wine. You eat and drink a little wine. You'll be all right. "Forsake the foolish and live. Go in the way of understanding. He that reproveth the scorner getteth to himself shame, and he that rebuked a wicked man getteth himself a blot. Reprove not the scorner. You rebuke the wise man, and he will love thee." Right? So this is a woman who not only lays it out in very simple terms, also, you sit down and have a conversation at the table, and I'm going to learn you something, too, before all this, you know? And so she says, so the fear of Yahuwah is the beginning of understanding. And so let's go a little bit further. The foolish woman, verse 13, is clamorous, and she is simple. "Knoweth nothing, for she sitteth at the door of her house on a seat in the high places of the city." So she ain't done nothing. She ain't cooked. She ain't cleaned up. She's sitting at the door. To call passerbys who write on their way. "Whoso is simple," right? "Let him come in hither. And as for him that wants another standing," she said to him, "stolen sweet waters are sweet, and bread eaten in secret is pleasant. Mm-hmm. But he knoweth not that the dead are there, and that her guests are in the depths of hell." Mm-hmm. Right? So this idea of a seductress, "I'm not going to do nothing. I'm just gonna sex you up. So I'm going to look good." Mm-hmm. So this is the woman who always looks good, and she always got it going on, but she don't have nothing going for herself. But she done seduced you into her house, and the dead are there. Meaning a lot of people have come through there, and she don't know nobody, and don't nobody know her, right? Because you're simple, because you didn't want understanding. She's like, "Don't understand me. Don't even get to know me. You don't even have to get to know me. All you got to do is come get some," right? Where a woman, where you think she's withholding a woman, what she's saying is, "Come eat. Come sit. Let's drink. Let's talk. Get to know me. Let's have a relationship." And then all the other stuff is just natural, right? So, this is that type of woman. The next one is the idea that sex is experience, okay? So, the idea of sex is not supposed to be something that's like wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. I mean, there's a time, I'm sure, for that, when there's desire. If it's mutual. If it's mutual. You know, sometimes you don't have all the time in the world.
Kids. Kids is coming.
Right. Right. It's a quickie. Right.
You gotta go back to work.
Right. So you just, you know, I'm not gonna leave you wanting. So we'll finish this later. Okay. So there's a place for it, but it's an experience. Okay. And so it's not just something for physical pleasure though. Right. Mm-hmm. So Solomon, right. Solomon is another person I really like. I would have liked him because he is a very wise man. And I would have liked for some of these men to know him so they could talk to him also. He did a lot of wrong things, but the reason why he got in trouble for doing the wrong things is because he knew better. Mm-hmm. So Proverbs 5:19. So Solomon is talking to his son, right? And he says, "Let thy fountain," 5:18 says, "Let thy fountain be blessed and rejoice with the wife of thy youth," right? And he says, "Let her be as a loving kind and a pleasant roe. Let her breast satisfy thee at all times. And be thou ravished always with her love." Mm-hmm. So, this word ravish. Me and Marvin, oh my gosh, this is hilarious. I'm not going to tell you guys any kind of sex stories. Don't even trip. this idea of ravish. We looked at this word ravish. And so we were looking at what it meant. The word ravished here actually means to err. To err, like to err. To do something in error, but in error. Okay, so it means that you're so ravished with her at first, I thought I meant this, that she can lead you astray because you're so in love with her, right? But Solomon is Solomon, and Solomon had a lot of wives. So Solomon was talking in a whole other direction. He's saying this, what he's saying is let her satisfy you, meaning that you constantly want her, be ravished with her, and that you want her. But it literally means this. The word is shag. Right? Shin Gimel. And it literally means to err. So it means to literally have a double burden. It means when your work is finished in error, it must be done again. Mm-hmm. What he's saying is, do it over. Do it like you erred. You didn't do it right the first time. And then go back and do it again. You didn't do it right that time. And don't stop until you've done it right. Mm-hmm. So this idea of sex being selfish is foreign to the Hebrew man. This is what the men were supposed to be teaching their sons. Well, the women are supposed to learn to reciprocate and do all these things. The man is supposed to learn how to please. The pleasure is the man's job. The conjugal right is the woman's. He's supposed to be satisfying her. And in return, she satisfies him. So he, right, he can't help it. Right, right. It's going to happen for you. So then make sure, if you don't think you did it, do it again. And maybe one more time. And maybe one more time after that. Just to make sure that you did it right. Right? And then be satisfied. Right? That's what Solomon's telling him. Act like you did it wrong. If you have to think about it. And then be satisfied. Because if you're satisfying her, guess what she's going to do? She's going to go over and beyond and satisfy you. So selfish sex is evil sex. And evil meaning ra. It means dysfunctional. It does not function because only one person is satisfied. Mm-hmm. And when only one person is satisfied, then the contract is lopsided again. Right? It is. So
it can cause distress.
Yes. It can cause distress and destruction.
Right. Transgressing.
Now my Bible said raptured.
Right, to be caught up. To be caught up. To be to be just totally engulfed. Okay, so if this is the idea that sex that is one-sided is evil, right? And it's supposed to be an experience. As you can see, that's an experience. So it's also supposed to be mutual, and it's not supposed to be manipulated. So we dealt with that, with the shaga. What was the word I gave you? Shakab. So it's not. It's supposed to be mutual, meaning you're not supposed to manipulate. You're not supposed to do the tambourine, make her dance, mm-hmm. Get what you want. You're not supposed to whore the daughters of Zion. You don't seduce her and then uncover her and then trash her and throw her out. Then you turn her into a whore. Because a woman, once you, one, if she was a virgin and you ignited her sexual desire, then she's going to have to meet that, right? And then on top of that, now you've stolen from her family because the woman, what happens with the woman, this is funny. The reason why the family gets a dowry for the woman is because when you take a woman out of the house of her father, you take work away from the house. See how it's not the other way? Mm-hmm. Now you're gaining something by taking my daughter. She's going to add fortune to your house. She's going to have children, and she's gonna grow your home. So when you take her, then you have to give something. Same way with the Levite. You had to purchase, if you wanted to have your son or your son not go and work in the temple, then you had to pay something because you're taking something away from Yah's house by not permitting them to work there. The woman is the same way. Okay? So, sex is mutual, not manipulated. Selfish sex is evil. And sex is never supposed to lower a person's self-esteem. Mm-hmm. So the last point. So, Genesis 24:17-20 And it says, we'll be done right after this. I know we were long. It says, and the servant ran to meet her, and we're talking about Rebecca, right? And said, let me drink a little water from thy pitcher. And she said, drink, my lord. And she, Adoni, right? And she hastened and let down her pitcher upon, gave him drink. And when she had done giving him drink, she said, I will draw water for thy camels also until they have also done drinking. And she hastened and emptied her pitcher into the trough and ran again into the well to draw water and drew for all of his camels. So this is a test for her, right? So the word here is found on page 192 of this book, but it's arah. Arah. And this is actually a very, very,
which
very...
word is that?
Arah.
But what
ayin resh hay.
It's right here.
But what English word is it?
Oh, it's the idea she's emptying her website. Okay. I was gonna read it. So ayin resh hay. And it's on page 192. So this has to do excuse me, my voice went out. So this has to do with the idea to remove something, right? Pour out until it's empty. Okay? And so this idea that sex is never to lower self-esteem is you're never supposed to take away until she's empty. You're not supposed to take it. When you take it and you make it empty, it becomes bare. So I'm sorry. Because I want this picture. I want this to stand everybody's view.
What does a wrong
mean? That's why I was going to pull it out of here. Because I was going to give you... an abstract meaning, and I know better. So it means to literally, it's the same word for what it says, to uncover someone's nakedness, right? It's the eye is a picture of an eye, and the resh is a picture of a man. So it means to see the man. So it's when the enemy is captured, he is stripped of his clothes to the skin and carefully watched. I shared this word with you guys before. So for the woman, for this arah, it means to uncover, and it means to remove the covering, to remove the contents of a container, or to destroy a city. So it has to do with the idea to leave something empty and destitute, okay? Mm-hmm. So what she did was she poured out until she had nothing left. And so in this sense, it was a beautiful picture because when you're talking about a matriarch of a people, we're going to be the Hebrew people, she marries Isaac, right? She was somebody who was going to give her all in order to, she was a servant. Mm-hmm. She was going to pour out her all. So what she would need is a man who wasn't going to take it because he already knew she's going to pour out her all. She was going to give her all. So the idea is to never leave a person empty. To open a container, remove the contents, and leave it bare. When a man takes something from a woman, when you have sex with her, you're opening the contents and you're taking from her store. So a woman of virtue is never supposed to be taken and laid bare. So you're not supposed to only please yourself. You're not supposed to not know her because those are the things that pour into her and allow her to keep doing what she's supposed to be doing. You're supposed to go over and beyond just like you watch her go over and beyond. If you watch her go over and beyond and you don't meet that, then how can you expect anything from her because she has nothing to give?
Empty down.
Right? Because a virtuous woman will empty her own vessel and you don't have to take it from her. Rebecca came. She not only gave him water, he didn't ask her to water the camels. And she went back and wanted all of his camels also, which means that she wasn't coming to take either. She was coming to give. Mm-hmm. And because when a woman comes to give, that's the kind of woman that a man should match with and say, because you're not taking, I'm going to fill you. Because you're willing to pour it all out, I'm going to pour into you. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to invest in you. And I'm going to get to know you. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to make sure that you're satisfied. I'm going to make sure that my eye is not lazy and wandering all over the place, right? So pleasing oneself breaks this connection. So the couple then, because they're in contract, teaches one another how to be pleased. The man is not supposed to leave the woman unsatisfied, and she's not supposed to leave him unreciprocated. Because as he is watching intently makes you furrow your brow, which means it takes intense concentration. So to yada her means you have to be really, really trying. So if a man's really, really trying, you don't fail to reciprocate that. And if a woman is pouring out herself, then you don't fail to reciprocate that. Sex is not something that is used as a tool in order to satisfy your lustful deeds and pleasures. Mm-hmm. It's done within the confines of a contract in order to flourish and build the family. Mm-hmm. Right? So it's done in love. And if you want to further on love, there's a video on love. But it deals with the idea of one giving to two. The Aleph giving to the Bet. To increase and to flourish and to sacrifice in order for the family to continue, in order for there to be balance and order within the family. And the only time there's order is when things that Yah put to be beautiful are not taken out of context and abused. Yeah?
Good. Royalty. Royalty. Powers of the chosen people.